Welcome to the Peace Talk, this time with Professor Johan Galtung. Johan Galtung is a Norwegian sociologist, the founding father of the discipline of peace and conflict studies. He was the main founder of the Peace Research Institute Oslo, short PRIO, in 1959, and he served as its first director until 1970. He also established the Journal of Peace Resarch in 1964. Galtung has been a major figure of the New Left since the 1950s. He is known for his research and contribution to sociology, political science, economics, and history. He has developed several influential theories and concepts, such as the distinction between positive and negative peace, structural violence, theories of conflict, and last but not least, he invented the term peace journalism. Johan Galtung, I'm very glad and honored that you found the time for this talk, for this peace talk. I admire your work and I'm very happy that you found the time.
You're so welcome. So welcome.
So, Professor Galtung, you're a major figure in the intellectual figure of the New Left since the 1950s. And you developed a concept of peace journalism. So, could you explain what is peace journalism about, and why do we need this, especially in this time?
Well, you can ask yourself, is there such a thing as health journalism? And there is. There are quite a lot of journalists specializing in health issues. And peace journalism would have the same argument. Peace is important for all of us, so we need journalists who are specializing and know something about it.
So, how do you define peace? It's the absence of war, or is it more?
That is so-called negative peace. The absence of war and violence. And the positive peace will be the presence of cooperation for mutual benefit.
Okay. Supportive relationships and solidarity and so on and so forth.
You may put it that way, but you know, let me just point out one thing. Solidarity is an attitude, a sentiment. But when we are talking about peace, we are talking about more active cooperation, you know, for positive peace.
Yeah.
The important distinction is between negative and positive peace. And most of the thinking in the field has so far been negative peace, that means to avoid war and violence. And when it comes to the method, it has been balance of force. I on purpose don't say balance of power, because the people talking about it are actually thinking of force. Balance of force. So we are saying in peace studies, this is a much too limited approach and a very negative approach. We need a more positive approach, where cooperation for mutual benefit, CMB, and often we say for mutual and added benefit, CMAAB, they play a crucial role.
I understand. It's very important, yes. And would you agree with me that peace journalism should also include a heavy critique of capitalist production, exploitation? It's more than just writing about what's going on in the world and about power structure. It's like... you understand, it's like critique.
Well, definitely critique. but also praise. I mean, nobody would be arguing that capitalism hasn't also done something good. So it is this kind of richer attitude, not only being critical or only praising, but combining the two, that I would say is characteristic of peace journalism.
I understand, yes. And you developed a concept which is quite popular. It's the it's your definition of violence. You developed this concept of structural violence. What is it about this concept?
Well, it's a good idea to start with the other one, actor violence.
Mm-hmm.
You see, actor violence is intended and it is perpetrated by an actor. In structural violence, there is no intention and it is not perpetrated by somebody,
mm-hmm.
but it simply is built into the structure. And women will immediately point out, oh, how good that you say that, because this has been the structure between men and women for ages. And only now, slowly, there is some consciousness about it and some effort to rectify it, to put it more right.
I totally agree, yeah. But
and you could then say the same. I would say that there is in the world a kind of rule of the middle-aged over the very young and the very old. Now, the middle-aged are now stretching their concept and they are incorporating older people and younger people. I would say that is to the good because you get a very diversified concept. And you get dissenting voices inside the groups and very much that can be steered in the direction of mutual and added benefit, as we say.
Yeah, that's absolutely right. And feminist scholars point that out, that there is a division between old and young, between men and women. And nowadays, there are a lot of studies that showcase this and use your concept of structural violence and so on and so forth. So it's quite important.
It's quite important, but then, of course, I very much insist on adding these dimensions. You can talk about women and women, and you can talk about young and old. But how about talking about older men on top of younger men and older women on top of younger women? In other words, combining the dimension.
Mm-hmm.
And I combine very frequently 8 dimensions and have found that very useful. And then you see, you have the very top, the one who scores high, who is high on all 8 dimensions, and the very low being the opposite. So that way you get a much richer concept.
I understand, yes.
You have to remember all the time that I have a sort of a double education,
mm-hmm.
in mathematics and in sociology. So that has made it possible for me to bring mathematical concepts into sociology.
Mm-hmm. Very interesting, yes. May I should ask you some personal question. What was your role model? Did you have any role models when you started your study, when you started your academic career? Who did you read?
My role model was built in into my family, and that was health. So you see, I very frequently quoted the formula I came up with, that peace is to violence and war, like health is to illness.
Very interesting.
And very often they use, for health, they use the concept of wellness. Wellness to illness.
Okay. You founded the Peace Research Institute Oslo. Could you describe your work there? What did you experience there? For what reason do you found this institute? What was the purpose and what was your idea behind this foundation?
Well, you may say my whole inspiration came from theory and practice and research on health. And sorry for mentioning it, because I mentioned it so often. That came from my family, you see. My father being a medical doctor, his father the same, his father the same, and so on. My mother being a nurse, and maybe most important of the all, the father of my mother being the director of health in Norway. And you know, that particular role, director of health, sort of combined, if you will, health and politics. And that suited me well as a model to combine peace and politics.
It's wonderful, yeah. It sounds like an idealistic approach to help people. It's wonderful.
I don't call it idealistic, not at all. There are ideas behind it, but that is not idealistic as a connotation of the unrealistic. Whereas I would say this is the realistic approach.
Yes.
So I certainly don't use that word, idealistic.
I understand, yes, you're but right.
Inspired by an ideal. No, you see, we have made quite a lot of progress in health, because health is not only an ideal, it's a reality we can describe, and we can describe its opposite, the opposite of health being illness. We can also refer to health as wellness, which is pointing to the idea of feeling well, which you can immediately then translate into the idea of feeling peace. Not only thinking and speaking and acting, but feeling it inside you. I have tried to cultivate that feeling. It's a good feeling. You feel, so to speak, at ease with everything and everybody. And you feel floating on all of that. I just use metaphor, but it's an important one. So this is just to enrich the concept a little bit, if you don't mind.
Yes. It's like the concept of deep listening. It's like listening with your heart also, not only with your brain. I believe feminist scholars developed this concept of deep listening.
That's a very good metaphor for it and a very good parallel. Totally agree.
Yeah, nowadays and especially...
If you say deep listening, you can of course also say deep viewing.
Yes.
And deep hearing, that you already said. But you can add deep viewing, deep seeing. Mm-hmm. But to do all of that, including the deep listening, you need some guidance by some concepts, because you need what to look out for, if we are talking about deep viewing, and what to hear out for, if we are talking about deep listening. So some guidance is needed.
And some goal. And also you need a goal, I believe.
Precisely. And this is why I have been so much inspired by health studies. Because they have a goal called health. And it was seen for a very long time as being administered by nevertheless than God. And that health was a gift from God for believing in him, and that illness was the well-deserved punishment by God for not doing so. Remember, this kind of thinking had a very strong hold on people for centuries. And I think we have had much the same in the field of peace and war. That war is a punishment for our bad behavior. And it's all administered by God, and more particularly by the Christian God. So one approach to health, as also to peace, is to become a good believing Christian. Well, I have tried to liberate the peace studies from that kind of thinking, and rather try to define peace as cooperation for mutual and added benefit. Cooperation for mutual benefit. But as I said, if possible, not only for mutual benefit, but for more benefit, added benefit. CMB, cooperation for mutual benefit. And I get very impatient with people who are unable to define their concepts. We're only talking about peace and health and as blah blah, and are not able to define it. I would call it sloppy thinking, and that they have to start working seriously. I have tried to do that, and I just shared with you a definition I came up with.
It's wonderful, yes. And it's also it's also logical, because we are all human beings. We are exposed in this world, and we need to respect the body and the integrity of every living being. And it's quite logical that everyone wants to be protected, to be loved, to be secure. So health is a central, it's logical for me.
Thank you. And we have to be aware of that, you know, that my health also depends on your health. For instance, if you are carrying a contagious disease, it's in my interest that you cure that one. And correspondingly, my peace depends on your peace. If you are carrying the idea of promoting yourself by means of war and violence, it's in my interest that you change that idea. And I can try to sit down with you and have a dialogue about it, and try to convince you that cooperation for mutual benefit, CMB, is a much better approach. And it doesn't mean that you get less. You can even get much more than you would have been getting by going it alone. But you have to reconcile yourself to the circumstance that the other side is also getting more.
This is very
cooperation crucial. From mutual benefit is not a bad definition.
This is very crucial because nowadays I have the feeling that we forget this that we are socially connected, that the human being is a social animal, like Aristoteles once said, zoon politikon. So we are connected to each other. We are a political and social animal, and this interconnectivity is very crucial. So we always have to keep this in mind, because this liberal paradigm that we are now living in, it says that we are individuals, we have to pursue our egoistic interests and so on and so forth. So this is the ideology of these days. So it's very important to remember us that we are social connected, and yeah.
I think that is very well put by you. And I will just point out that there is a difference, it seems, between humans and other animals. And I'm not at all sure of what I say. I'm just saying it as a kind of hypothesis, that animals seem to be coded in a particular way. Termites, to make what termites live in. Ants, to make what ants live in. Bees, to be busy with honey. And sucking it and doing the wise and nice things that bees are doing. Now, what are we doing? Well, whatever we are doing, we are capable of changing it. In other words, we are programmed, like, as you pointed out, you use the expression other animals. We are programmed, but we can change that program. And I would then say that we are programmed in our body and in our, what would you call it? I try to avoid the word soul, you see, so I prefer to use the word mind. We are programmed in our body and our mind, but our spirit is not programmed. Our spirit has that remarkable capacity of thinking new thoughts. And if you look back at human history, you will find new thoughts being produced all the time. And it will continue like that into the future, as long, as far as we can imagine. That's quite something.
Yeah. It's very important to point this out, yes. And on the contrary, what we see is a capitalistic system. And capitalism, for me, is a power structure that exploits not only human and animals, but also natural resources. And what we are seeing now is this environmental problems and so on and so forth. So capitalism is the contrary of what you said now.
I would agree with you for some definitions of capitalism. But you could imagine looking at it a little bit differently, namely seeing capitalism as an opening if you have capital. And that raises the question, how can we make sure that everybody has some capital? In other words, could there be a capitalism for everybody, so to speak, that would be mutual, for mutual and equal benefit? Since for me, those three words, mutual, equal benefit, are so important.
Yeah. I agree.
Yes, I think it could. And that could be a more modest social capitalism. And I think one should also be open to seeing how could that be developed further, and could that be a part of a literary peace cocktail, to put it in that appetizing way.
Yes, yes. That will be great, yeah. The technological progress we can keep, of course. There are some benefits of capitalism. There are some good dimensions of capitalism.
And it is capitalism and capitalism. There is this terrible capitalism where all the capital ends up on very few hands, and what is distributed to the rest is misery. And there is a capitalism with some capital, not too much, for everybody. And I, being a Norwegian, I'm always thinking of the Norwegian Social Democratic Parties, the Labour Parties, saying, yes, capitalism can do much good, but can also do much bad, and for that reason it has to be limited, and the way of limiting it is through taxation. And using that taxation to make for better living conditions for the lower third. So one way of putting it would be tax the upper third, use that to improve the conditions for the lower third, and let the middle third stay where it is and serve maybe as a model.
Yeah, I agree. The Scandinavians are successful with this transformation of capitalism. They put capitalism a human face, so to speak.
Precisely. In other words, there is capitalism and capitalism, as there is socialism and socialism. And no socialism that is very distributive, and wants a chance for everybody. And I read about, experienced socialism, that is dictatorship by a communist party.
Yeah, that was a terrific experience.
Exactly. You know, we have had lots of experiences, and we have to, so to speak, look at them critically and creatively. Both critically and creatively, in the sense of identifying what was bad about it and what is good about it. And here I think it's very useful to remember it is also something bad in the good and good in the bad. And bad in the good in the bad and good in the bad in the good. And so on.
Yeah.
This yin-yang sequence that Chinese thinking, Taoist thinking, is so much insisting on.
Yeah, and Mikhail Bakunin once put it, liberty without socialism is privilege, injustice, and injustice. Socialism, on the contrary, without liberty is slavery and brutality. So we need both. We need liberty, we need some sort of capitalism, and we need socialism. We need both.
That was very well put by Bakunin, yeah? But then Bakunin, seen as the founder of anarchism, has been misunderstood, I think. Because anarchism, to him, didn't mean an archaic structure, no structure at all, but it meant local structure. So to me, Bakunin was in a sense a pioneer in small is beautiful and very much to be celebrated today.
I totally agree. I totally agree, yes. And unfortunately, anarchism is viewed nowadays as destruction, as violence, but it's unfortunately it doesn't tell the whole story. Anarchism is, like you pointed out, and Kropotkin also said, mutual aid. So in the center of this ideology or this political view is solidarity, localism, the small is beautiful, like you said it. And yeah, this is in my belief, in my point of view, this is crucial in anarchism.
And you know, we have something small in the world. It's usually called a municipality. Some of them may be too small and may cooperate with their neighbors, for instance. Some of them may be too big and could stand some subdivision. But we have a good model at the municipal level. So municipalism is one approach to what we have been talking about.
Yeah, maybe it is the future. We will see.
Yes. Maybe localism. But as Alexander King always pointed out, small is beautiful, but some big is necessary.
That's also right, yes. Some decision must be made globally.
Precisely. At the so-called higher level.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I think that is reasonable, as long as we don't short shrift the lower level. And we have been given, you know, the municipal level as a model of that. And as I mentioned, some municipalities may have to be combined and so could better be split up. And that process is going on all the time.
And also, I wanted to point out that in anarchism, there is this radical egalitarian approach. And in my view, like we said in the beginning, with the health and feelings and so on. So we need to respect the body and the health and the integrity of other persons. And this is also totally and radical egalitarian. And in my point of view, anarchism is also this idea is that we are all equal in this sense, that we are all human beings exposed to others and so on.
Precisely. And dependent on each other.
Yes, socially connected, yes.
And that is why the word mutual so often comes in, you know, like a mutual aid and mutual benefit. I help you because you help me. I help you with the hope that you will help me when I need it. And it will be to my benefit and it will be to your benefit. The word that survives all of that is the word mutual.
And the contrary to this would be the social Darwinistic view. So, like Darwin in the social science, that everybody, like Thomas Hobbes once said, we are in a war against each other, and also we see this in neoliberal thinking that we need to develop great ideas than the others. So we are in a competition. This is the contrary to what we said.
And that in Latin is homini. Homo, homini lupus est. Man, or people, are wolves to people. It's a very negative view, but not unrealistic. And then you have the contrary statement, humore sacra hominibus. Humans should be sacred to human beings. So this is, if you combine them, a sort of starch realism on the one hand, homo homini lupus, and then on the other hand, a remedy as a strong idealism, homo re sacra hominibus. You know, one reason for quoting them in Latin is in order to point out that these are very old ideas. And one might ask, have they helped us? Have we in fact made progress? And I would say undoubtedly yes. I'm amazed when I look around the world, seeing how many parts of the world are living peacefully with other parts. Sometimes the reason for the peacefulness is sheer distance. They don't even know of each other at times. But sometimes it is that they have made some experience with both, with violence, war on the one hand and cooperation on the other, and found that cooperation pays off much better. There is, of course, the point that the other pays off also much better for the other side. But then how about sitting down with the other side and go for mutual and added benefit by the cooperation approach? Well, you may then ask me, are we doing more of that? I think we are. And I think we have big chunks of humanity cooperating quite a lot.
Yes.
And that's already quite something.
In order to do that, I believe, we need to develop structures, a political system that brings more peace, that bring more mutual aid. Because the human is like, we have a part that is destructive, and one part that is love and solidarity and mutual aid. So I believe we need to develop a structure that brings out more of the good than the bad.
I totally agree with you. Definitely. And that structure in peace studies is called a horizontal structure. And the model is the round table. And the opposite structure is called the vertical structure. And the model is a triangle, with no connection between the lower parts. One part directing it all. So we have very clear images of both sides of what we are talking about. The good side and the bad side, the peace side and the war violence side. But that means that we know what we are aiming at. And one objection that always comes up, which is a very, very important objection, but we are too numerous. We cannot all sit around the table. You cannot put all 7 million plus of us, billion plus of us, and sit around the table. No, but you can take some of us and sit them around the table, and some others and sit them around the table. And then you can somehow have an organization for bringing what they found out together. They could also sit around the table. You may be several levels are needed, and several approaches are needed, but nobody has said that that cannot bring very good advances to everybody. And we are in fact doing much of that, you see.
Yes, this is very important for democratic societies, because if they wanted to label them democratic, so they need to involve everybody, or as much as it is possible. Yes, and
they may have to make it possible for them all to be involved, and that presupposes what I just call horizontality. Because if you have a very vertical, multi-layered society, nobody will listen to those at the bottom. And those at the bottom, have nothing to rely upon and know that they are doomed. And that is only a question of when they will die.
Yes, yes. It's very paternalistic also.
In what sense do you mean?
No, I mean it's paternalistic to this vertical model. I wanted to say this vertical structure is very paternalistic in the sense that there are some people, like Noam Chomsky put it, that they believe that they are more intelligent, they can view the future, and on the opposite, they say that there is this mass. And they are emotionally, they cannot see the future, they are not intelligent and capable to, for politics. They are not capable doing politics. And this hierarchical model, Noam Chomsky criticizes often in his lectures.
Precisely. And I should always be pointed out, the best solution for those at the bottom is to die, to disappear, without too much noise. In other words, there is an opening in the sense of getting rid of them, not in the sense of supporting them. But here, standing up against that, you have the Nordic welfare states saying just to the contrary, take care of them, support them. If they are weak, they may need even more support. And it doesn't help to say they should support themselves. They may not be capable of, and they may need some help. In that case, make the chances of survival and have a good life more equal.
Yes, that is very
and
important.
And one model has always been, you have to finance this, so tax the upper third, subsidize the lower third, and leave the middle third more or less as it is.
Yeah, that's a good concept. I believe the Social Democratic Party is trying to do that. But unfortunately, they lose from year to year more voters and strength. For example, in Austria, I can see this.
For instance, in Austria. So what will happen, do you think?
The problem is that our society is polarized, and I believe that there are some rhetoric on the neoliberal side that in order to keep our competitiveness, we need to stop the taxes, deregulate the market, not regulate, and so on and so forth, and to cut the social welfare state. So this is the rhetoric, and the result is unfortunate, because the result is that more and more people do not get access to the social welfare state, more and more people are getting poorer, and this leads to, this is one factor, which leads to populism and the right sector. So it's an unfortunate vicious circle. And this tendency I can see with Trump, with Bolsonaro in Brazil, and in Austria as well, in Hungary. So there, this dynamic, this negative dynamic of capitalism in this negative sense, that that I believe I can see.
I agree with you, and I see the same thing happening. The question is, how do we counteract it? And here, you know, being a Norwegian, I think the Nordic welfare state model is, that's one approach, and it has proved quite effective. And the welfare state model is that if you cannot support yourself, if you're able to, there will be help for you. There will be a minimum of welfare guaranteed for you. And we assume that you will use that well and then make yourself more independent of any kind of support, but be able to work, making money, and the state would say, be able to be taxed so that we get more money to help those who are not able to do it. Well, as you know, some of those who say that want to get more money in order to help themselves. And you get a very lopsided, very wrong formation coming out of it. It has to be detected, and it has to be counteracted. And the best way of counteracting anything, for that matter, is to show a model that it works. And the best way to show an example, a case, I try to avoid the word model, because model is so comprehensive, includes so many aspects. But you have to try to show something that works. And for that you need experience and experiment. Experiment to gain experience, and the experience of all those experiments. And you have to say, look, this is something that seems to have worked in many cases. How about trying that one? But for heaven's sake, um Gottes Willen, don't promote it as a world ideology. Try it out in the small, and we have fortunately many smalls. They are called municipalities. And as far as I understand, there are about 2 million of them around the world. That's quite a high number. And you can even invite them. Are there some municipalities who could imagine volunteering for an experiment to gain experience? There will always be some that would like to volunteer. And they could make experiments. Let us say, leaving the rule to women only. Or, as you pointed away, leaving the rule to democracy, to having a vote. But should that vote be on people or on issues? Or on both? And how do you combine them? And so on, so on. There are many questions, and we are wrestling with those questions.
Yeah.
Is fascinating. And I belong to those who think we are gaining some experience.
Hopefully, yes.
Hopefully.
Yes. And I believe the welfare state is a good model, but let's remind us that this is a privilege of some countries, and it is not popular in the world of countries. So, like, it's a privilege of the global north. Not many countries of the global south has a functional and good social welfare state. And this is also, there is this this division between global north and global south. For example, John Ziegler once put it, every child which dies of hunger has been killed. And this also showed this difference between the global north and global south. Historically, it is clear imperialism, colonialism, and nowadays it continues to be this division. So, a social welfare state in the global south is rare. And we need to change also the international political structure in order that everybody can be happy and that everybody can pursue a good life.
That everybody can enjoy welfare as opposed to ill-fare. And we have a lot of ill-fare in the world and a lot of efforts to justify it. People die. People die of hunger. People die of diseases that are entirely curable. And yet there are other people who say that was well deserved. They didn't have the will, the strength to survive. Oh yes, they did, but they had very strong forces against them. And sometimes they didn't have enough strength themselves, but they did help. That help was not available. To the country, there was the ideology that life is a struggle, and how you are doing in that life is in terms of survivors and not survivors. If you are heading for not survival, for death, prematurely, so be it. It's well deserved because you didn't have the strength. To that, the obvious answer is, but couldn't that strength have been developed? Also, couldn't there have been some help instead of just sacrificing them to the statement, if you don't have the strength, you will die, and it's well deserved? Well, you see, the people who said that possibly also didn't want it because they didn't want to have too many people on board. The more people you have on board in a ship with limited resources, the more resources for everybody. The answer would be, who said there is only one ship with resources? And who said that more resources cannot be developed? And this debate is well known, it's been going on and will continue into the future.
It's a long debate. I believe Plato and Aristoteles also debate this topics more than 2,000 years ago. So nothing changed, I believe.
The debate is about the same. Exactly. But something did change. An enormous amount of people are today enjoying welfare, not ill-fare. Not necessarily a welfare state, but they are living quite well. And they are living into old age. And there are fewer people who die much before that. You know, you don't have to go much back in time to find that the normal age of dying was around 30. Today, 70, 80, 90, and just going higher and higher and higher.
Yes, that's
and
true.
And the question is, being given more age, how do they use that additional age? What do they do? And you would sort of hope that they would acquire more wisdom and could distribute more wisdom to the younger. And much of that is happening, in fact. But the younger will have a tendency to say, these people are too old. They reflect ages, long time past, and we'll develop our own. So thereby you get not only dialogue between genders, but between generations.
Yeah.
And both those dialogues should be encouraged. They are crucial to our survival.
You put it very wonderfully. Yeah, I agree.
Thank you. Thank you. It's nice to know that we agree, because these are important things to agree upon.
Yes. So, I don't have any further question. If you want to add something.
No, I may not have any further answers. I think I have said quite a lot. And I think we could just say goodbye for now.
Yes, I thank you very much for your time, for your patience, and for this wonderful conversation. And I learned
thank
a lot.
Thank you indeed for this wonderful. I very much like that you used the word conversation and not interview, because we were really talking together about this. Goodbye for now.
Goodbye. Have a nice day.
Same to you.